Hello friends and welcome to StudyIQ. I'm Joycey Joy and today in this lecture we will analyze the PM Kisan scheme which was introduced in the interim budget of 2019. First of all, coming to the current affair. The recent interim budget which was presented by the Union Government gave a strong focus on rural economy and the farm sector, that is the rural agricultural sector, by introducing PM Kisan. So PM Kisan is Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi, which is also known as PM Kisan. So before moving on to the analysis of PM Kisan, let us first understand what is the issue with regard to rural agricultural economy. The rural India is predominantly agrarian in nature. That means that a majority of the population living in the rural India undertake agriculture and allied activities as a source of their livelihood. But there are many issues that are related to agriculture as a source of livelihood. And among them, the most important is the absence of a better price discovery mechanism in agriculture. So this has impacted the livelihood of the farmers, which means that they are not getting decent remuneration for their produce. And along with this is many other issues like fluctuations in production, lack of technology, lack of irrigation facilities, insurance, lack of mechanization, the role of intermediaries and many others. So the agricultural sector, which is predominantly in the rural area of the country, is vulnerable to price fall and therefore a fall in their income. So many governments, both the central government as well as the governments at the state level, they have implemented many schemes in order to help the farmers out of the situation. Agriculture is a state subject and therefore it is a jurisdiction of the state governments to make laws in agriculture. So various state governments, for example, the Telangana government has introduced the Raitu Bandhu scheme, the Odisha government has introduced the Kalia scheme, the Madhya Pradesh government has introduced the Bukhtar Bhavandar Yojana. So various state governments and the central government itself has come out with various measures to help the farmers overcome this situation. So one such measure or a mega scheme was announced in the recent interim budget of 2019 and it was known as PM Kisan or Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi. So we will analyze PM Kisan in depth in this lecture. Now moving on to PM Kisan and various features of PM Kisan. PM Kisan is Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi. So it is an income support scheme announced by the Union Government in the recent budget. So an income support scheme means that the government is trying to provide certain income to the agricultural sector or the farmers. So this is to supplement the income they earn. So the income that the agricultural sector or the farmers earn sometimes even doesn't allow them to meet their livelihood needs. So government is trying to provide certain income support or a supplementary income to these farmers who are in distress. So we will see what are the conditions in order to avail the benefits of PM Kisan. So under the PM Kisan, every family owning a land ownership of less than 2 hectares. So this is largely targeting at small, medium and marginal farmers. So the condition is that the person who applies for this scheme shall not own more than 2 hectares of land. Therefore, the benefits are restricted to small, medium and marginal farmers. And according to PM Kisan, those eligible farmers will get an yearly direct benefit transfer of 6,000 rupees. So 6,000 rupees would be directly transferred to the bank account of the farmer. So this can eliminate any possibility of leakages because the income is transferred directly to the bank account of the farmer. And also on the other hand, this will enhance financial inclusion as well. Farmers will have operative bank accounts because these transactions will be done through the bank accounts of the farmers. So 6,000 rupees per annum will be provided to the farmers in order to supplement their farm income. And this 6,000 rupees would be provided in 3 installments. That means 2,000 rupees into 3 installments. And coming to the coverage under the scheme, it is likely to cover 12 crore farmers or 12 crore beneficiaries who belong to small and marginal category. And the annual budgetary allocation for this scheme set up by the government is ₹75,000 crore. So this 6,000 rupees which would be received by the farmer can be used for the purchase of inputs, or this can be used as an investment in undertaking production activities, etc. So this will supplement the income of the farmers. So the objective of the government is to help the farmers through an income support scheme in order to overcome the rural distress or agrarian distress, and to help the farmers with a supplementary income of rupees 6,000 per year per farmer. Now coming to the administrative mechanisms involved in PM Kisan. The first one is the Aadhaar requirements. So from the second installment onwards, we have seen that the 6,000 rupees would be dispersed as 3 installments. So from the second installment onwards, it is mandatory that the beneficiary need to have an Aadhaar identification. But this is not compulsory in the first installment, because government has announced that the first installment would be provided as early as possible, that is within 2 to 3 months. So it is not mandatory that in the first installment the beneficiary should have an Aadhaar identification. Alternative identification documents have been provided to the beneficiaries for the first installment, but later on, from the second installment onwards, the beneficiary should have an Aadhaar identification. That is the first requirement. And the second one, regarding the fund distribution, the state governments would be given a maximum of 0.25% of the funds transferred to the beneficiaries in the first installment in order to pay for the administrative expenses in the implementation of the scheme. So from this, it is clear that the implementation of the scheme is the responsibility of the state government. And while implementing the scheme, the state government will have to undertake certain administrative expenses. So the central government would be providing 0.25% of the total funds that are distributed to the beneficiaries in that particular state as a fund to the state government in order to undertake the administrative expenses in implementing the scheme. So this is regarding the first installment. And from second installment onwards, the fund that would be transferred to the state governments would be only 0.125% of the total funds that are distributed to the beneficiaries in the state. So this is to undertake the implementation cost or the administrative cost in implementing the scheme. So this is the second administrative mechanism. And third one is regarding the land requirements. So we have seen that the condition to avail this benefit is that the farmer should hold less than 2 hectares of the land. So therefore, a proper land record of the farmer along with a functional bank account is compulsory to avail the benefits of the scheme. So the first one, that is the availability of proper land records, this is to improve the transparency and also to improve and also to ensure that the benefits are given to the eligible beneficiaries only. So this is the intention. And secondly, a functional bank account is necessary because the fund would be transferred directly to the bank account of the farmer. And this is also to help improve the financial inclusion among the agricultural sector or in the rural India. So this will help in improving financial inclusion, especially in rural India. And now regarding the land records. So this land records would be provided by the land revenue and block agricultural officers. And the central government has asked the state governments to prepare a database of beneficiaries. That means the database should include all the details of the small and marginal farmers who are the beneficiaries. For example, the land holdings, whether they belong to scheduled caste or scheduled tribe community, or the details of the bank accounts of the beneficiaries, the mobile numbers, the Aadhaar details. So such details has to be collected by the state government, and the state government has to maintain a database of all this important information regarding the beneficiaries. Now coming to certain shortcomings of PM Kisan. Firstly, the PM Kisan aims to cover small and marginal farmers. That means those who own less than 2 hectares of land. So 85% of the farmer population is included in this category. But the major shortcoming here is that this scheme has not provided any feature that would include landless agricultural laborers and tenant farmers. The same shortcoming we have seen in case of Telangana government's Raitu Bandhu scheme as well. So Raitu Bandhu scheme is based on land ownership. Similarly, the central government's PM Kisan is also based on land ownership. That means The tenant farmers and the landless laborers are excluded from this. Whereas we will see that in case of Odisha state government's Khalia scheme, it has got separate features for landless laborers, for tenant farmers as well. So here we will see that the central government has excluded tenant farmers and landless agricultural laborers, who are the most vulnerable category. Now the second one is regarding the database. Now it is the responsibility of the state government to provide database of the beneficiaries, that is small and marginal farmers. But in many states we will see that they do not have maintained a database for land records of the farmers, and within the short period of time it would be difficult to collect all the data from the farmers and to keep a database. And there are also associated concerns at the operational level: land record reconciliation, digitization, cost incurred in consolidation of land records, etc. And in certain states of the country, the ownership of the land would be community based. That means there is no single owner for the land, but the community owns the land. This is the case especially with northeastern states of the country. So here most of the land is community based. So here the government would face a difficulty in identifying the beneficiaries. The beneficiary would be a community, not an individual. So that would be another challenge. Now let us understand what more should have been done with the PM Kisan. First of all, agriculture is a state subject. That means the jurisdiction is with the state governments in order to implement or to come up with laws that is related to agriculture. So the responsibility of the central government should be to create or to provide an enabling environment to the state governments. So this can include creating a responsive bureaucracy, ease of doing business, market infrastructure creation, trade facilitation, etc. So central government should restrict itself by creating a enabling environment rather than making laws and schemes for subjects that are included in the state list. It should also facilitate the provision of insurance facilities to every farmer in order to overcome the risk associated with farming. And the central government should also involve in public-private partnership in order to render services to the farm sector at a fair price. For example, mechanization, availability of technology to the farm sector. Such things can be done through public-private partnership, and the central government can provide an enabling environment in order to facilitate this. And moreover, the central government's goal must be to reduce poverty, ensure sustainable food security, inclusive growth and well-being of farmers. We have seen that many state governments have implemented their own schemes like the Raitu Bandhu, Kalia scheme, Bhavandar Bukhtar Yojana. So the state governments should be allowed to come up with their own schemes and policies for their farmers. So the central government should restrict itself from creating an enabling environment for them. You can find the PDF of this lecture on my Facebook page, and for any queries regarding your UPSC preparations, you can get in touch with me on my Facebook page, or you can email me at joycy.studyiq@gmail.com. Thank you.